Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Chop Suey, A Cultural History of Chinese Food in the United States, by Andrew Coe, narrated by Eric Martin. Chapter 1. Stag's Pizzles and Bird's Nests. On a frigid morning in February 1784, the Empress of China set sail from New York Harbor. It was embarking on the most ambitious expedition yet attempted by a United States vessel. At the helm stood Captain John Green, a pugnacious 6'4" veteran of the Continental Navy, with many passages to Europe and the Caribbean under his belt. For this trip, he couldn't count on that experience. His only guide would be a British pilot's manual that listed what little was known about the reefs and shoals, ports and trade winds his ship would encounter on the journey. If she survived, Captain Green estimated the voyage would take over a year, perhaps as much as two. The Empress of China was setting out on the first American trip to China, the era's equivalent of the 1969 journey to the moon. As the ship emerged onto the open Atlantic, its timbers cracked and groaned under the weight of its cargo. Barrels in the hold carried almost $20,000 in Spanish silver and 30 tons of dried ginseng root from the mountains of Pennsylvania and Virginia. The Empress's owners, some of the young nation's most powerful businessmen, hoped to trade the silver and the ginseng for the tea, silks, and porcelain of China. To sustain the ship's 42-man crew, Captain Green had filled every remaining space, both below and above deck, with food and drink, enough provisions to last 14 months at sea. This included enough fresh water to last 5 months and 48 barrels worth of alcoholic beverages, mainly white Tenerife wine, strong Madeira wine, brandy, and old Jamaica spirits, rum. The wine and brandy were reserved for the officers. The thirsty crew had to make do with the throat-scorching rum. The Americans on board the Empress of China carried their culinary traditions with them. On their journey to the other side of the globe, they ate the food of the pan-North Atlantic tradition, from the United States to the British Isles, adapted for the ocean voyage. Their staples were salt beef, salt pork, potatoes, and bread. The food eaten by the officers and the food eaten by the crew were of distinctly different quality. Coops filled with chickens and pens of sheep, pigs, and goats were lashed onto the decks. While this supply of livestock lasted, they provided fresh meat for the officers' cabin. The bread for the officers was soft and baked fresh by the ship's cook. The crew had to gnaw on rock-hard, worm-infested ship's biscuit. Dinners at the officers' table could include butter, pea soup flavored with bacon, roast meat, meat pies, boiled potatoes and cabbage, cheese, apples, condiments, and cake or pudding for dessert. As they embarked in the dead of winter, fresh vegetables were almost totally absent. For the sailors, meals were a monotonous round of salt meat, potatoes, and biscuit, interspersed with peas or beans. All of this was washed down with weak beer that was brewed on board. 3 times a week, the crew enjoyed their rations of rum, and on Saturdays they were given the treat of a raisin and molasses-sweetened pudding. Both officers and crew were served a nautical specialty called lobscouse, a stew of salt beef, sea biscuit, and potatoes, though again the sailors had to chew on the butt ends of the meat, while the officers had the best cuts, stewed with cabbage and carrots, as well as potatoes. Everybody on board seasoned their food with vinegar to keep scurvy at bay. A month into the voyage, the Empress landed at the Cape Verde Islands off the coast of Africa. Leaks in the side were caulked, and the crew loaded more water and fresh food for the officers, chickens and goats, 2 pigs, and some oranges. The next leg of the journey lasted 3 months and 18 days, during which the men hardly sighted land or other ships. It was one dreary waste of sky and water, the purser wrote. Toward the end, the men were so starved for fresh meat that they captured and threw in the pot some booby birds that appeared and flew around the ship. Samuel Shaw, an officer, noted that they were lean, very fishy, and but indifferent food. The crew also attempted to snare an albatross, but it broke the line and escaped. Shaw was the Empress's periwigged supercargo, its business agent, and the second most important man on the ship. Aged 29, he was a native of Boston, and from an early age had been destined for commercial pursuits. In 1775, he had enlisted in the American Army and risen to the post of aide-de-camp to one of George Washington's most important generals. At the war's end in 1783, Shaw had been recognized as a young man to watch. According to his biographer, the judgment, fidelity, and capacity for business which he had displayed in the American Army attracted attention and general interest, and an association of capitalists who had united for the purpose of opening a commercial intercourse between the United States and China offered to him the station of factor and commercial agent for the voyage. Ambitious, and with barely a penny to his name, he had accepted immediately. In mid-July, the men finally sighted Java Head, the tree-covered promontory on the Sunda Strait, the channel between the islands of Java and Sumatra. Their ship dropped anchor in Java's Mew Bay, where it was met by Muslim natives in two canoes proffering chickens, fish, turtles, vegetables, fruits, coconuts, and even live monkeys for sale as sailors' pets. Already at anchor in the bay were two French ships, including the Triton, which was also heading to China. The bonds of friendship between French and Americans were then particularly strong, thanks to the French backing of the Americans' side in their war for independence. Shaw and the other American officers were invited to dinner aboard the Triton, as elegantly served as if we had been at an entertainment on shore. The French captain offered to guide the Empress on the last leg of the journey, a proposal the Americans gratefully accepted because of the many islands and uncharted shoals between Java and China. Just before they set sail, the French and Americans spent a day planting Indian corn, oats, peas, beans, and potatoes on a nearby island. At the end of their work, they toasted the success of their garden, which they hoped to harvest on the return voyage, with bottles of Madeira wine and French champagne. On August 23, 1784, after 6 months at sea, the Americans finally came within sight of the Chinese mainland. They had arrived at the coast of Guangdong Province, at the mouth of the Pearl River in southeast China. Here they encountered a Chinese fishing boat, crewed by the first Chinese they had ever seen, and for $10 hired its captain to guide them up the river. After maneuvering past some rocky coastal islands, the Empress of China and the Triton anchored off the city of Macau on the river mouth's western banks. Administered by Portugal since the 16th century, this settlement had a distinctly southern European aspect, with large whitewashed houses, narrow winding streets, and green trees and gardens. The Empress fired a salute of greeting, which was soon answered by a salute from the city's fort. Shaw had the honor of hoisting the red, white, and blue colors of what was then called the Continental Flag, the first ever seen or made use of in those seas. Early the next morning, a silk-robed Chinese customs inspector climbed aboard and took down the particulars of the boat and where it was from. He then impressed a piece of paper with the large seal that gave the Empress permission to travel further into China. After he left, the American ship was swarmed by little Chinese boats whose owners offered eggs, sugar, and breadfruit for sale. 2 days later, the Empress raised anchor and set sail up the Pearl River for the city of Guangzhou, also known as Canton, 60 miles to the north. The journey from Macau to the anchorage at Wampu, 12 miles down the river from Guangzhou, was a favorite subject of the era's travel writers. This 2-day passage gave European and American voyagers their first real encounter with the people and sights of one of the world's most fabled lands. As they sailed north, the river was increasingly crowded with all kinds of boats, including odd-shaped fishing boats, enormous flat-bottomed cargo boats, and the war junks of the Chinese Navy. Some of the boats were evidently home to whole families and the flocks of ducks they tended. Others were piloted by fishermen who used tame cormorants to catch their fish, preventing the birds from swallowing their prey by fastening iron rings around their throats. The Western ships sailed past Chinese forts whose gun emplacements were painted with fearsome tigers and demons. As the land flattened out, the sailors saw bamboo and banana trees, and then miles and miles of rice paddies as far as the eye could see. After 2 days, they arrived at Wampu, the furthest upstream a deep-drafted ship could travel, where a line of tall masts was already waiting. The Empress of China anchored at Wampu on August 28, 1784, and fired a 13-gun salute to the other ships already riding there. French, Danish, Dutch, and English boats all returned the salute. Soon Shaw and Captain Green were visited by the officers of these ships, starting with the French, who assisted the Americans in getting moored and arranging their passage into Guangzhou. For anyone who hadn't yet heard of the American victory over the British, Captain Green carried copies of the Articles of Peace and the treaties between the United States and the various European powers. 2 days later, the American officers took a Chinese chop boat into Guangzhou. As they approached the city, the sights and sounds and smells, the culture shock of being in China, would have overwhelmed them as they passed pagodas 9 stories high, temples, rice paddies, orange plantations, more forts, and hundreds or even thousands of boats painted with glaring colors. Every now and then they would have heard the crash of cymbals and gongs the Chinese boats used instead of cannons to greet each other. From the river, the Americans could just barely glimpse the city itself. The view was blocked by a seemingly interminable line of one-story buildings, mostly warehouses that crammed the waterfront. Here and there between these buildings, the Americans would have glimpsed the crenellated city wall, and behind it an occasional rooftop, a distant pagoda, and the roofs of some of the larger temples of the city, all topped with tile roofs. During their 4 months in Guangzhou, Green and Shaw were never allowed to enter the city proper. Instead, they landed on a wharf attached to a 12-acre compound on the riverfront at the southwest corner of the city wall. Here, the Chinese had built 13 two- and three-story warehouses with white facades and columned verandas fronting the river. These buildings were called factories because they both housed and provided workspaces for the foreign factors, the business agents of the European trading companies. According to imperial edict, this compound was the only place in China where Western nationals could come and go more or less freely. After he returned to the United States, Shaw presented a report about his venture to John Jay, the U.S. Secretary of Foreign Affairs, precursor to the Secretary of State. Unlike many European travelers, Shaw did not feel that he could discuss Chinese life and culture. In a country where the jealousy of the government confines all intercourse between its subjects and the foreigners who visit it to very narrow limits, in the suburbs of a single city, the opportunities of gaining information respecting its constitution or the manners and customs generally of its inhabitants can neither be frequent nor extensive. Therefore, the few observations to be made at Canton cannot furnish us with sufficient data from which to form an accurate judgment upon either of these points. This statement was something of an evasion, particularly considering Shaw's status as leader of the first American expedition to China. Numerous writers with even less direct experience of China than Shaw penned extensive works both before and after his visit. It's more likely that he was actually not that interested in China itself. He was the first representative of the group that dominated American contacts with China for the next half century, the canny but narrow-minded New England traders. The vast, complicated, exotic, and ancient country of China lay just outside the door, but all they focused on was making a profit. Indeed, Shaw's description of his time in Guangzhou begins, "To begin with commerce, which here appears to be as little embarrassed and is perhaps as simple as any in the known world." The Guangzhou factories were owned by a small group of wealthy Chinese merchants who had received imperial permission to trade with foreign trading firms. The most powerful of these, the British East India Company, also known as the Honorable Company, occupied a sprawling factory in the heart of the compound, right on the central square. The Union Jack flew out front. British traders and Chinese authorities had a complicated relationship. Each side accused the other of arrogance. Backed by the mighty British Navy from its base in Calcutta, the East India Company had established trading ventures throughout South and Southeast Asia. In China, however, the emperor limited their business to Guangzhou, cutting them off from the rest of the vast China market, and refused to meet with their representatives or even the English king's own emissaries. In Guangzhou, British traders occasionally vented their frustrations by beating any coolies who had the misfortune to bump into them on one of the compound's crowded streets. On the Chinese side, the main advantage of trading with the East India Company was the substantial revenues it brought to the emperor's personal coffers. The main disadvantage was, as the Chinese saw it, that the foreigners were crude and quarrelsome, pushy, and utterly unwilling to adapt to Chinese customs. The emperor believed that letting them come any further into his empire would only upset the harmony of Chinese society. For now, the trade continued because it was profitable, although both sides could see the possibility of conflict further down the road. Shaw's sympathies lay naturally on the European side of this relationship. However, as a newcomer to the region and from such a young country, he wasn't exactly in a position to take a stand. His first concern was the business at hand, selling his ginseng. The Americans first stayed in the factory rented by the French, but soon secured their own place of business. The first floor of their factory was divided between a warehouse, a counting room, and a treasury. The American living quarters were on the second floor. The landlords provided a phalanx of Chinese servants, from cooks to porters, to carry the Americans' goods and cater to all of their needs. In order to communicate with both these servants and the merchants, the Americans had to learn the crude local trade jargon known as pidgin Chinese. The word pidgin probably derives from the word business, and appropriately so, because it was primarily used for commercial transactions. Pidgin was a unique combination of Portuguese, English, and Cantonese, with a few words from India thrown in. The jargon had evolved from necessity. The disparate trading communities from the Bay of Bengal to the Western Pacific needed a way to communicate with one another. Go catchy chow chow meant fix something to eat in pidgin, which sounded very much like a parent talking to a recalcitrant and somewhat deaf child. Neither the Chinese nor the Europeans had bothered to learn their trading partners' native tongues, so pidgin was used in all interactions between them. In a sense, both sides were talking down when they used pidgin. However, in contemporary English and American accounts of life in Guangzhou, we only hear the Chinese side of the conversation. To readers, this has the effect of infantilizing the speakers. It's hard to respect someone who talks in such an ungainly manner. For Shaw, his first problem was explaining to the Chinese exactly who the Americans were. On being the first American ship that had ever visited China, it was some time before the Chinese could fully comprehend the distinction between the Englishmen and us. They styled us the new people, and when, by the map, we conveyed to them an idea of the extent of the country, with its present and increasing population, they were not a little pleased at the prospect of so considerable a market for the productions of their own empire. Shaw was also insecure about how the European contingents in Guangzhou would treat the Americans. After all, the United States was barely 8 years old, a toddler on the world stage, and had recently waged a bloody war with Britain, the world's rising imperial power. He was gratified to find that the attention paid us at all times by the Europeans, both in a national and personal respect, was highly flattering. This was expected from their French allies, but even the British went out of their way to shower the Americans with attentions. During their first few weeks in Guangzhou, Each of the foreign factories invited the American party to elaborate meals in their personal quarters. Shaw doesn't say it, but attending those dinners must have caused him great anxiety. During the 18th and 19th centuries, a man's character was very much tied up with his manners. The more refined his social graces, the more civilized he was thought to be. One's behavior in public was a matter of performance, constantly judged by those present, and the most crucial of such performances was the meal. As Dr. Johnson said, the hour of dinner was the most important hour in civilized life. In the United States, Shaw had dined at the tables of American generals, but he had never before ventured abroad and had no experience of foreign customs. All that was said about dinner table etiquette in Lord Chesterfield's advice to his son on Men and Manners, the only etiquette book then published in post-revolutionary America, was that every gentleman should study to acquire that fashionable kind of small talk or chit-chat which prevails in all polite assemblies, and also learn the art of carving. A man who tells you gravely that he cannot carve may as well tell you that he can't blow his nose. It is both as easy and as necessary. In Guangzhou, Shaw would have been acutely aware that his social status was, at best, unsettled. His hosts were worldly Europeans, direct heirs to centuries of courtly tradition. Shaw and the American party were provincials, almost frontiersmen, living in a land at the edge of the wilderness and very, very far from the heart of European civilization. It was crucial for them to behave with grace and good manners, because a misstep would not only bring shame on them personally, potentially harming their China endeavor, but also dishonor their country. The invitation that gave Shaw the most trepidation was probably his dinner in the sumptuous quarters of the East India Company. In accordance with their commercial dominance and their role as the de facto representatives of the world's rising imperial power, the British traders lived in regal luxury. On the second floor of their factory, they enjoyed a library, a billiards room, a chapel, and an enormous dining room called the Great Hall. When Shaw stepped into this room, it would have been decorated with crystal chandeliers, with portraits of the king and various directors of the company on the walls. Doors opened onto a terrace overlooking the Pearl River. The long dinner table, set for 30, glittered with silver candlesticks and cutlery and the finest porcelain. The guests were seated strictly according to rank, with the chief British trader acting as host and Shaw sitting next to him as the guest of honor. Although the meal was prepared by Chinese cooks, the food was strictly elite European cuisine. In the 18th century, this meant a strong French influence, the remnants of medieval spicing, including clove and nutmeg, and probably an Anglo-Indian curry or two. There would have been two courses of at least 10 dishes each, from a cream-based soup to roast teal and blancmange, followed by a dessert of fresh and dried fruits and walnuts. Copious amounts of imported alcohol would have been poured throughout, including red, white, and Madeira wines. Frequent toasts, during which all the diners would stand, would have been made to the king, the U.S. president, the emperor of China, the success of the diners' business ventures, and so on. The richest men of Boston, New York, and Philadelphia could not have provided a more elaborate feast. Apparently, the Americans' behavior at the dinner was a success, and they passed the social test. After the meal, the chief British trader pulled Shaw and Green aside for a little private talk. Over another bottle, he apologized for the Americans' reception in Guangzhou. He had meant for the British, not the French, to give the first reception for the newcomers. "For trust me, gentlemen, that we would not designedly have put you in such company." During his 4 months in Guangzhou, Shaw saw as much of the city as Europeans who had been trading there for a dozen years. In other words, he was mostly confined to the 12-acre compound that held the factories and the three narrow thoroughfares that ran beside them, Old and New China Streets and Hog Lane. These were lined with stores selling souvenirs, including silks and hand-painted porcelain, and grog shops dispensing rot-gut liquor to the sailors. Beyond the compound, the streets into the city were blocked by gates that were manned 24 hours a day. The only way a foreigner could travel further was with official permission and in the company of a Chinese interpreter. Shaw made only a handful of trips outside the western compound. One of these was across the river to the island of Hunan, also called Hunan, where most of the Chinese merchants who traded with the foreigners kept sprawling homes and gardens. In the company of some French merchants, Shaw and Green were invited to dine at the house of Chokwa, the trade name of Chun Zuguan, a member of a prominent merchant family. Shaw was particularly impressed with Chokwa's gardens. Much art and labor are used to give them a rural appearance, and in some instances nature is not badly imitated. Forests, artificial rocks, mountains, and cascades are judiciously executed and have a pleasing effect in diversifying the scene. He tells us much less about what they ate. What struck him was that, on these occasions, the guests generally contribute largely to the bill of fare. At Chokwa's, the French supplied the table furniture, wine, and a large portion of the victuals. This was common practice during the 18th and 19th centuries, because most Western merchants in Guangzhou were not culinary adventurers. The French brought the table furniture because they couldn't use Chinese spoons and chopsticks, the wine because they preferred that to hot Chinese rice wine, and the victuals because they couldn't stomach the dishes prepared by Chokwa's chef. One of the exceptions to this rule was an English rake, William Hickey, who had been shipped east in 1769 to find his fortune and to keep his hell-raising escapades from further blotting the family name. Unfortunately, he was more interested in fast living and sleeping with Chinese prostitutes than knuckling down to work. During his stay in Guangzhou, he and some other Englishmen were invited to a series of banquets at a Hunan mansion. On the first night, the meal was served à la mode anglaise, the Chinaman on that occasion using, and awkwardly enough, knives and forks, and in every respect conforming to European fashion. On the second night, everything was Chinese, all the European guests eating, or endeavoring to eat, with chopsticks, no knives or forks being at the table. The entertainment was splendid, the victuals supremely good, the Chinese loving high dishes and keeping the best of cooks. By high, Hickey probably meant that the dishes were rich and luxurious. Another meaning of high is slightly rotten, as in the aged game dishes preferred at many English aristocratic tables. The Chinese, however, liked their meat absolutely fresh killed. After 4 months in China, Shaw finally sold his ginseng at a good price. It turned out that the quality of his product was better than anything his European competitors had brought. The Chinese merchant with whom Shaw sealed this transaction complimented him for not behaving like a rude, difficult Englishman. "But you speak English word, and when you first come I no can tell difference, but now I understand very well." Nevertheless, he doubted that the American's polite behavior would last very long. "All men come first time China, very good gentlemen, all same you. I think 2-3 time more, you come Canton, you make all same Englishmen too." By the end of December 1784, the Empress of China's hold was packed with hundreds of chests of bohe and hyson tea, yellow Nankin cloth, silk, and porcelain. The customs authority issued its Grand Chop, which gave the Empress permission to leave China, and on December 28th, she raised anchor and set sail for the United States. Other American ships were already heading east across the Atlantic, around the Cape of Good Hope, and then on to China. Shaw and the crew of the Empress had inaugurated the era of the China trade. For the next 60 years, traders from ports like Boston, New York, Philadelphia, and Salem, Massachusetts, would set sail for the other side of the world, lured by the chance to become rich by trading for the tea and finished products of one of the world's largest and oldest nations. These traders' adventures led to one of the most remarkable and unlikely culinary exchanges of the last few centuries. In 1784, the United States and China were, respectively, the youngest and oldest countries on Earth. The Americans were then still working out the most basic principles of government. The Constitutional Convention would take place 3 years later, and just beginning the process of deciding what made their culture distinct from England and the rest of the Old World. The Chinese, in contrast, had become one country over 2 millennia earlier and could trace their lineage as a culture back to the dawn of history. Unlike the new nations of Europe, who could not ignore the achievements of Mesopotamia, Egypt, Greece, and Rome, China had almost always been the dominant culture in its region, East Asia. As a consequence, many Chinese thought of their country as the Middle Kingdom, the center of human civilization. It was thanks to some of their legendary rulers that humankind had first learned to use fire, to hunt and to fish, to sow crops and build houses, to treat illness with medicine, to write, and to mark time with calendars. The Chinese had also developed a highly complex system of government, at whose apex stood the emperor, ruling under what they called the Mandate of Heaven. As long as the emperor remained virtuous, Shangdi, the supreme ruler of heaven, would give him command over all humanity. In 1784, China was governed by the great Qianlong emperor of the Manchu-dominated Qing dynasty. He wielded power from his throne in the Hall of Supreme Harmony in Beijing's Forbidden City, which was off-limits to all except his closest retainers. Expanding outward from this point, the Chinese traditionally divided the world into a series of 5 concentric circles based on an ancient plan ascribed to the legendary Yu Emperor. First came the royal domains, meaning all the lands within the borders of China directly ruled by the emperor. All Chinese were, by definition, civilized. The core of these domains was what Westerners called China proper. The 18 provinces extending from what is now Hubei in the northeast to Hainan Island, then part of Guangzhou province, in the south, and to Sichuan in the west. Just beyond China's borders lay the lands of the tributary royal princes, the kingdoms of Korea, Laos, Vietnam, Tibet, Mongolia, and others. Made humble by the presence of the Chinese behemoth next door, their rulers had decided that it was usually far better to accept Chinese supremacy in East Asia than fight it. They learned Mandarin Chinese, converted to the Chinese calendar system, and at regular intervals donned Chinese costume and traveled to the court at Beijing to give costly tribute to the emperor. In return, he would invite them to an imperial Manchu banquet, 6th grade. Beyond these tributary kingdoms lay the zone of pacification, where the people were in the process of adopting Chinese civilization. For some, this process was remarkably rewarding. The ancestors of the Qing dynasty's Manchu emperors were Jurchen tribesmen, semi-nomadic farmers and hunter-gatherers in northeastern China. Over the centuries, the Jurchen chiefs carefully studied the Chinese imperial system. When the Ming dynasty fell apart in the early 17th century, the Jurchen roared down from the north and occupied Beijing. They renamed themselves the Manchu and founded the Qing dynasty on a basis of strict obedience to the Chinese imperial system, in effect becoming more Chinese than the Chinese. Beyond the tribal lands and tributary kingdoms, the rest of the world was encompassed by the outer 2 circles of the Yu Emperor's map, called the Zone of Allied Barbarians and the Zone of Cultureless Savagery. The Allied Barbarians were the peoples who had regular contact with Chinese civilization but did not have the wisdom to adopt it. This title encompassed many of the tribes on the empire's northwest frontier, whose regular raids across the border had led to the construction of the Great Wall. The rest of the world's peoples lived in the zone of cultureless savagery, of which the ancient Chinese had no direct experience. Instead, their knowledge was based on tomes like the Shanghai Jing, Guideways Through Mountains and Seas, 4th century BCE to 1st century CE, a kind of guidebook to heaven and earth that blends geography, cosmography, mythology, and natural history. Much the way Greek, Roman, and medieval European works describe unseen lands, the Shanghai Jing describes those who live in the far corners of the earth as looking not like, well, people. Beyond China's borders lie the land of hairy people, the land of feathered people, the land of people with perforated chests, the land of three-headed people, the land of giants, the land of midgets, and so on. The book tells readers nothing about how these weird inhabitants actually live. For that, the Chinese would apply what they had learned from their interactions with tribes on the margins of the empire, as in this passage from the Li Qi, a book of ritual form that Confucian scholars drafted, 5th century to 221 BCE. The tribes on the east were called Yi. They had their hair unbound and tattooed their bodies. Some of them ate their food without its being cooked. Those on the south were called Mon. They tattooed their foreheads and had their feet turned in towards each other. Some of them also ate their food without its being cooked. Those on the west were called Zung. They had their hair unbound and wore skins. Some of them did not eat grain food. Those on the north were called Ti. They wore skins of animals and birds and dwelt in caves. Some of them also did not eat grain food. Qin Dynasty accounts also often speak of alien peoples, including Europeans and Americans, and their customs in similarly belittling terms, describing their primitive taste in food, almost animal-like physical appearance, and so on. Over the millennia, this streak of anti-foreign bias in Chinese culture was balanced by intense curiosity about the outside world. From the Han Dynasty, 206 BCE to 222 CE, on, the Chinese did have regular contact with the rest of Asia. Chinese ambassador John Qian roamed across Central Asia and even as far south as India, documenting the regional cultures and economies for his Han Emperor. Regular trade between China, India, and the West began with the opening of the Silk Road by 100 BCE, and likely earlier. Traffic in goods and ideas also traveled by sea, on ocean-going junks sailing to Japan, to many ports in Southeast Asia, and across the Indian Ocean to East Africa. Perhaps the most lasting result of those contacts was the dissemination between the 2nd and 7th centuries CE of Buddhism, which originated in India. Over the centuries, the tribute network the Middle Kingdom established with its various vassal states became the official channel by which the finest products of foreign lands, from gems to foodstuffs, directly reached the emperor for his pleasure and enjoyment. Between 1405 and 1433, the Yonglu Emperor of the Ming Dynasty sent Admiral Zheng Hu's fleet of 300 ships on expeditions extending from Southeast Asia to Africa to assert Chinese power and expand the tribute system. In 1601, another Ming emperor hired the Italian Jesuit priest Matteo Ricci to serve as his court mathematician and cartographer. Ricci introduced Western geometry and trigonometry and drafted accurate maps of the world showing latitude and longitude and the main continents. He could speak, read, and write Chinese, saw no contradiction between Catholic and Confucian beliefs, and converted many scholars and officials to Christianity. Even today, the Chinese admire Ricci for his deep knowledge of and respect for their culture. By the time Ricci died in 1610, Europeans were a constant presence at the edges of the Chinese Empire. This incursion had begun in 1517 with the arrival of Portuguese traders who soon acquired the rights to anchor at and then settle in Macau. They were followed by the Dutch, and then in the 17th century, the Spanish, French, English, and other European powers. The imperial government saw their presence as decidedly a mixed blessing. The European trade became highly profitable to the emperors, who took most of the profits directly into their coffers, restricting contacts with the European traders to the port of Guangzhou in order to protect their imperial monopoly and for fear of foreign contagion. Imperial China was a highly organized yet delicately balanced machine, Who knew what kind of cultural, economic, or political instability these strangers would bring? Official knowledge about Europe and its various peoples was designedly inadequate because it was considered dangerous to learn more. Aside from the storerooms of the Forbidden City, the only place where Chinese could have seen European maps was Guangzhou. In the mid-18th century, imperial courtiers drafted a massive 10-volume encyclopedia, the Illustrations of the Tribute-Bearing People of the Qing, 1761, that gave the official view of the outside world, one heavily influenced by the view of ancient texts like the Shanghai Jing. All foreign peoples are defined by their level of allegiance, imaginary or not, toward civilization, that is, the Middle Kingdom. The authors do not bother to correctly locate England, France, Italy, Holland, Russia, or even the Atlantic Ocean. The inhabitants of the European countries are described as having dazzling white skin, lofty noses, and red hair. They favor tight clothes, their disposition is warlike, they esteem women more than men, and all they care about is trade. In traditional China, since at least the days of Confucius, merchants were relegated to the lowest rung of social status. To imperial officials, the behavior of the Europeans resembled more that of dogs or sheep than that of civilized human beings. When the Empress of China, a European style of ship with a crew who spoke the same language as the English, arrived in Guangzhou, local businessmen like Chokwa may have been curious about these people's native land and glad to have new trading partners. To imperial officials, however, they were just more red-haired, white-skinned foreigners from the far-off zone of cultureless savagery. At the end of the American War of Independence, Americans knew slightly more about China than the Chinese did about the United States. For about a half century, the American beverage of choice had been Chinese tea, which was shipped from Britain in crates marked with the stamp of the British East India Company. In 1773, dozens of citizens of Boston dressed as Mohawk Indians dumped crates of company tea into Boston Harbor to protest unjust British duties on their favorite drink. Those Americans who could afford it drank their tea from delicate white cups of imported Chinese porcelain. Their image of China closely resembled the charming little scenes painted on the cup's sides, stylized little blue willow trees, a river, and a bridge with one or two white-faced figures on it. George Washington was supposedly surprised to hear that the skin of Chinese was not bone china white. During the 18th century, the British East India Company enjoyed a monopoly on all trade with Asia. Merchants in the American colonies were forbidden to travel to China or deal directly with Chinese merchants. What little the colonists could learn about China was gleaned almost entirely from books and other accounts written by European travelers. Probably the most famous was the Encyclopedic General History of China by the French Jesuit priest Jean-Baptiste du Halde. Both Benjamin Franklin and Thomas Jefferson owned copies, as did Franklin's Library Company of Philadelphia in 1770 and the New York Society Library in 1789. Du Halde never visited China, but he gathered his material directly from many Jesuit priests who had spent years there. His general history held up China's government, law, and philosophy as models for emulation. Voltaire became a Sinophile after reading it. Those Americans lucky enough to peruse the tome could learn of the Great Wall and the Emperor's Palace in Beijing, read the sayings of a sage named Confucius, and marvel at the rituals of a Chinese banquet where the most delicious dishes were stags, pizzles, and birds' nests carefully prepared. Also widely disseminated was the anonymous work The Chinese Traveler, 1772, supposedly based on the experiences of Jesuits and other modern travelers. A collection of stories of exotic customs and wide-eyed adventures in foreign lands, it reads more like Gulliver's Travels than Du Halde's measured account. Some of the information provided appears to have been picked up down at the London docks, including tips on where to find pleasure girls and warnings about trade. The Chinese excelled the Europeans in nothing more than the art of cheating. About Chinese food, the Chinese traveler notes many oddities, including the use of chopsticks, the prevalence of rice, and the practice of chopping the food into little bits before bringing it to the table. What particularly interests the author is the wide variety of animals the Chinese ate. They not only use the same kind of flesh, fish and fowl, that we do, but even horse flesh is esteemed proper food, nor do they reckon dogs, cats, snakes, frogs, or indeed any kind of vermin on wholesome diet. This description of the meats sold in Guangzhou delves deeper into that custom. I was very much surprised at first to see dogs, cats, rats, frogs, etc. in their marketplaces for sale, but I soon found that they made no scruple of eating any sort of meat and have as good an appetite for that which died in a ditch as that which was killed by a butcher. The dogs and cats were brought commonly alive in baskets, were mostly young and fat, and kept very clean. The rats, some of which are of a monstrous size, were very fat, and generally hung up with the skin upon them, upon nails at the posts of the marketplace. In nearly every Western description of Chinese food from the late 18th and early 19th centuries, this information is repeated. The Chinese dine on dogs, cats, and rats. Some of it comes from doubtful texts like The Chinese Traveler, but in other texts the information has enough detail to give it the ring of truth. And anyone who has visited modern Guangzhou's markets can see that they still sell an incredible variety of live animals for food, including dogs and cats. If readers of the time remembered anything about Chinese culinary habits, it was that they extended their eating habits to include beloved pets and filthy vermin. Books like Duhalde's General History and The Chinese Traveler were also popular because they contained large amounts of information about the country's economic life, the principal products of China, the goods it most commonly imported, and the workings of its commerce. Americans did not read these sections idly because the major source of their revenue was foreign trade. Merchants needed all the information they could find on the world outside their borders. After the War of Independence, Britain was still the dominant sea power, and its blockades kept American ships from much of Europe and the Caribbean. However, British power did not yet control the Pacific or the sea lanes leading to the world's most populous nation. In the 1780s, the ports up and down the east coast of the United States hummed with plans for voyages to China. The main promoter of these ventures was John Ledyard, an adventurer who had sailed with Captain Cook on his last voyage around the world. Ledyard proposed an enterprise to collect sea otter skins in the Pacific Northwest and sell them in Guangzhou for huge profits. When his backers realized that the scheme was too costly, they turned to what they knew from Duhalde's General History. The Chinese were said to pay enormous prices for ginseng, which they used in their traditional medicine. Within months, the hold of the Empress of China was packed with ginseng root and heading east to China. From 1784 to 1844, the yearly ritual of the China trade was nearly always the same. The American ships anchored at Huangpu at any time from August to October and unloaded their goods. The merchants took up residence in the American factory, with its flowery flag flying out front, and began the process of selling their wares to their Chinese counterparts. In the evenings, they retired to their quarters to eat sumptuous Western meals, washing the food down with copious amounts of imported alcohol, or traded social visits with the other foreign merchants. For recreation, they could promenade along the factory compound's waterfront, compete in rowing races on the river, or stroll in the nearby Chinese gardens in the company of an interpreter. We know that life in the factories was claustrophobic, but little else about what the Americans thought about China, because they were businessmen, first and foremost. They left few records of their experiences there, particularly during the first decades of the trade. After their wares were sold, they purchased Chinese goods to sell back in the United States: tea, silk, porcelain, Nanking cloth, and sundry knick-knacks with which they decorated their stateside homes. The Western ships usually sailed out of Huangpu in January. American merchants could then either sail home or spend the months until the next trading season in nearby Macau. With its picturesque setting, warm sea breezes, and large European colony, Macau was always considered a more pleasant place to stay than Guangzhou. From the beginning, American merchants faced a perennial quandary of what to bring to China for trade.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.